Hello, everybody. My name is Christian Finger Eriksen. I'm a senior consultant anesthetist from the country of Denmark in the city of Aarhus. My primary everyday work is neuroanesthesia and neurointensive care. And secondly, I'm part of the hospital's coagulation service and consulting. And my talk here today is entitled tranexamic acid. But first of all, I would like to declare my conflict of interests to this presentation, not really relevant, but for your information. When we're talking about tranexamic acid and treatment with tranexamic acid in a bleeding situation, this is what we want to avoid: hyperfibrinolysis. We know that hyperfibrinolysis, especially if it's a very severe hyperfibrinolysis, it is associated with a very high mortality. If you have a full-blown breakdown of the clot, as you can see on this Roten curve on the right, the mortality is close to 100%. So it's very relevant to avoid this kind of situation in terms of hyperfibrinolysis, and to avoid these clinical scenarios. The tranexamic history, more or less, the tranexamic history, especially in bleeding situations, more or less began with the CREST 2 trial, which you probably know already. This was published almost 10 years ago, and they included in this multi-center study with nearly 20,000 patients, they included trauma patients with significant hemorrhage. And the significant hemorrhage was defined as a systolic blood pressure below 90 and tachycardia and a significant bleeding problem. They were giving tranexamic acid or placebo, and as a result, they concluded that mortality in patients that received tranexamic acid were significantly lower, and the amount of patients that died due to bleeding or any cause was significantly lower. At the same time, there was no side effects in terms of vascular occlusion or multi-organ failure documented. So this was, so to say, the beginning of the tranexamic acid era, especially in trauma patients. And this is now the recommendations in a lot of countries and centers throughout the world. The tranexamic acid is given to bleeding trauma patient. These are the European guidelines suggesting as a grade 1A recommendation that a loading dose of 1 gram should be given, followed by an infusion over 8 hours. After the CREST 2 trial, this review came out in 2012, and please do not, it's not expected that you should read this table, but rather eyeball the box plots, because this review investigated the effect from tranexamic acid on surgical bleeding, not in trauma, but in general surgical bleeding in different various conditions, including 129 randomized trials with nearly 11,000 patients. And as you can see from the table on the left-hand side, all the box plots are located on the left, which means it favors tranexamic acid. So taking all together, tranexamic acid in addition to trauma has a benefit on blood loss in a wide range of different conditions. The woman trial was published in 2007 from the same group as did perform the CREST trial. They included 20,000 women with postpartum hemorrhage, and it was a clinical judgment. They gave 1 gram of tranexamic acid or they gave placebo. And the outcome measure was a composite one. It was all-cause death or hysterectomy. This was the primary endpoint. And they had secondary endpoints like thromboembolic events or surgical interventions. And they concluded that there was no difference in the primary endpoints, which mean death from all-cause or hysterectomy. There was no difference from tranexamic acid in this patient category. At the same time, they concluded there was no thrombolic events as a secondary endpoint. When they digged a little bit deeper into the results, they could find significant results on death due to bleeding. One point 5% of patients in the tranexamic acid group died, while it was 1.9% in the placebo group, and this was death due to bleeding, not death due to any cause. This was, as I said before, not different. Only death due to bleeding was significantly lower in the tranexamic acid group. So it seems that there was, although this was not a primary endpoint, it seems that it was a benefit from tranexamic acid in these groups. But saying this, it has to be taken into account that this study included patients from all over the world, including a number of African countries. And the mortality rate is quite high in some African countries compared with, for instance, Denmark. So I'm not sure we will see the same effect from tranexamic acid on mortality in your country or in Denmark, because the mortality rate is quite lower. But still, based on this study, there's good indication of giving tranexamic acid, but we have to keep in mind if the patients included in these trials really reflect those we are treating. So until now, a number of studies concluded a positive effect from tranexamic acid on bleeding. And in our institution, we wanted to test if a prolonged infusion of tranexamic acid could give even better results. So we included children undergoing craniofacial reconstruction surgery, because this kind of operation is associated with a high amount of blood loss, especially in the post-operative period. Within the first 24 hours, these patients tend to bleed quite a lot in the drainage from this cranium operation. So we introduced a regimen including tranexamic acid, 10 milligram per kilo plus continuous infusion, 3 milligram per kilo per hour for 8 hours. In a single center, double-blinded trial. And what we saw was a significant reduction in the total blood loss of these patients. Not during the operation, the blood loss was the same, but in the post-operative period and in total, there was a significantly reduction in blood loss, was quite high in these children. Total blood loss is approximately, in the placebo group, 50 milliliters per kilo, which is quite a lot if we assume a pediatric patient is carrying approximately 70 or 80 milliliters per kilo as a total blood volume. Blood volume. This is the blood loss during these operations is approximately 75% of the total volume. So this is, from a clinical point of view, this is a very relevant reduction in blood loss. What we also saw, and this is not surprisingly, that the amount of blood transfusion were reduced significantly, especially the amount of red blood cells were reduced significantly of course, due to the reduced blood loss in these children. So, continuing the discussion of tranexamic acid, this study evaluated the effect of topical administration, not intravenously or not as a tablet, but as a topical administration. And this was given to orthopedic surgery in which they gave or infused tranexamic acid in the drainage, in the wound drainage. They put in 2 grams of tranexamic acid. And they had some quite interesting results in which the red blood cell loss and the transfusion rate was lower in those patients who have had tranexamic acid as a topical addition to the surgery. A very interesting study. So taking together all these studies and surgical conditions I mentioned in which tranexamic acid have a beneficial effect, this has at least in my country caused a very steep increase in the amount of tranexamic acid given. This is the doses per year prescribed in the hospital system. And as you can see, in 2018, there's a quite steep increase from 2016 and later than that. But so the question is tranexamic acid good in every situation? And this study is published in 2015. It's 5 years old, and it's a retrospective study. So of course, this is not as high quality as the randomized controlled trials I've shown previously in this presentation, but it's quite interesting because they included only patients that have that could show hypofibrinolysis, which means they have a lysis index above 30. And this is a measurement of fibrinolysis. And only those patients were included in this trial. And then they investigated the patients who have had tranexamic acid or no tranexamic acid. And despite the fact that 1,000 patients were included, and despite the fact that those patients had documented fibrinolysis, there was no effect of tranexamic acid. There was no difference in mortality. And as a matter of fact, there was an unadjusted higher mortality in the tranexamic acid group, but I think we should not put too much conclusions into that. But the study is interesting because they included only patients with hypofibrinolysis and they could not find any effect from tranexamic acid. At the same time, when we discuss tranexamic acid, we have to take into account that the drug contains or holds side effects, as with all medication. Abdominal pain, diarrhea, nausea and vomit, headache and dizziness, this is a common effect, which I personally see very seldom because when we give tranexamic acid in the anesthesia department, it's very often in patients that are undergoing surgery are unconscious, so we don't see some of the side effects as well. Hypotension, you can see if you give the drugs too quick, if you infuse it too fast, hypotension can appear. Thromboembolism is, of course, relevant, and seizures has been associated with tranexamic acid. To talk about seizures, this review included 10 studies enrolling a lot of patients, nearly 26,000 patients with TXA exposure and nearly 7,000 without, and there was a cumulative incidence rate of 2.7% for seizures after tranexamic acid treatment. But what is more interesting is that the rate or the risk of developing seizures following tranexamic acid is is related very much to the dose, and you can see that the higher dose, the higher the incidence of seizures. And I have to admit, I have never experienced seizures following tranexamic acid treatment. And I think the reason why is that we nowadays give lower doses than what appears in those studies. The recommended dose is for bleeding is 10 milligram per kilo, or 10 to 15 milligram per kilo is the recommended dose. And as you can see, this is quite lower than those reported in these studies. So to my personal experience, if you keep the dose low, which means 10, 15, maximum 20 milligram per kilo, the drug seems quite safe in terms of seizures. So about mechanism of action of tranexamic acid, we know from the textbook that tranexamic acid inhibits the activation of plasminogen. In normal condition, tissue plasminogen activator, it activates plasminogen. Plasminogen is turned into plasmin, and plasmin can degrade fibrin network. When tranexamic acid, when tranexamic acid is present, it blocks the ability of activating plasminogen into plasmin, and plasmin cannot degrade fibrin network into degradation products. So this is the way it acts, according to the textbooks. If we look at how it acts in real life, these very nice electron microscopy pictures has been taken by some of my colleagues in Austria. And on your left-hand side, you can see a pre-operative picture of fibrin network. And on your left-hand side, you can see what happens if the patients are treated with tranexamic acid or placebo. In the bottom on your right, you can see a tranexamic acid-treated clot picture. And it's quite easy to see that the fibrin network is it's thinner, it's more dense, it's closer than the picture on your right above, in which placebo-treated bleeding patients have a network that is, it's a more coarse network. The fibrin strands are not so nice and close as they are in the tranexamic acid group. So it seems that it's definitely tranexamic acid causes the fibrin network to get more closely. And this is exactly what we would expect according to the mechanism of the drug. But what we would expect from this drug is that it should avoid fibrinolysis. And if we go back to the woman trial, some of the patients from the woman trial have had taken blood samples. They made a sub-analysis of 167 patients with postpartum bleeding. They took blood samples from these patients. And what I have marked with the red dot is the maximum lysis, how much fibrinolysis is present in these patients. And what you can see is that there's no difference between patients treated with tranexamic acid or with placebo in the maximum lysis, or if you look at the bottom, the lysis index or the clot firmness, there are no difference. And this is quite surprising, because we give tranexamic acid to avoid or to treat hyperfibrinolysis, but we cannot measure fibrinolysis in these patients. There are no difference in the groups, and this is a very surprisingly, that there's no difference, because we saw a quite clear effect on the bleeding, but we cannot measure it in the fibrinolysis assays in these patients. We did a measurement of resistant to fibrinolysis in patients having tranexamic acid, and as you can see from this table, We made a Rotem analysis, the maximum clot firmness, and we put in tissue plasminogen activator to stimulate fibrinolysis or to speed up the process of degrading the clot. And as you can see on the right-hand side, the patients who have had tranexamic acid and in which we gave the TPA in the cup in the laboratory, they had a reduced reduction of the clot firmness. And this means that the clot is more resistant to fibrolysis. And this is what we would expect from tranexamic acid, that that it would impair the breakdown of the clot. And this is exactly what we see, that the clot is more firm and dense in patients having tranexamic acid, and it's more difficult to break down by TPA. So this, to continue discussing on the effect of tranexamic acid, this figure is a sub-analysis from the CRESS trial. And they made an analysis of the timing of the tranexamic acid, and they concluded that if patient had tranexamic acid longer than 3 hours after the incident, it has an opposite effect. There was an increased mortality in patients who have had tranexamic acid later than 3 hours after the initiation of bleeding. And this is a very interesting observation, and we do not, or I do not have any good explanation on why this is the case. Why do we see a benefit of tranexamic acid if it's given early, and a bad effect on mortality if it's given after 3 hours later than the bleeding initiation? One explanation could be, there's not good evidence to conclude, but this is another interesting observation on fibrinolysis, because we know that patients with hyperfibrinolysis, they have a bad prognosis. They die from exsanguination. We know that hyperfibrinolysis is not very good for the patient, for the bleeding patients. They get bleeding shock, and some of them die due to exsanguination. Then we have the yellow patients, the patients that are bleeding and they have a physiological fibrinolysis. This is a very good situation. And then we have patients with a very low amount of fibrinolysis, the so-called fibrinolytic shutdown. These are very interesting because some of these patients, they have high mortality due to, not to bleeding, but to multi-organ failure later on. And this can maybe explain some of the observations done from the CRESS trials, that multi-organ failure and fibrinolytic shutdown are adverse events to tranexamic acid treatment. We do not know if there's a good relationship relationship between this, but this may be one model to explain why tranexamic acid is not a benefit in patients with fibrinolytic shutdown. And the reason behind this phenomenon called fibrinolytic shutdown is not well described. It may be due to microthrombus formation. It may be due to fibrin deposit in some end organs, or it might be due to a difference in fibrin structure if it's too late in the bleeding process. We don't know that yet, but it's a very interesting clinical observation that some patients develop severe hyperfibrinolysis, and some patients, they instead develop a kind of close down of the fibrinolytic system. So, and now to another issue, which is gastrointestinal bleeding. In 2012, this Cochrane evaluation, Cochrane report, was published, including 7 randomized controlled trials with approximately 1,600 patients. these patients, they have had tranexamic acid, or they had versus placebo or some kind of an acid production inhibitor. And if you look at this box plot, it seems that tranexamic acid was better in gastrointestinal bleeding, and this was also the first conclusion from this Cochrane analysis, that mortality was reduced in patients having tranexamic acid with gastrointestinal bleeding. But the studies included in this Cochrane review was not of a very high quality to answer this question. And it was associated with a number of bias. So when they did a quality control and correlated these bias to the results, there was they could not confirm a positive effect from tranexamic acid on mortality in gastrointestinal patients. So recently, this year, a randomized control trial was published in gastrointestinal bleeding, called it HALT IT trial. It's published from the same group in London as did the CREST trial and the WOMAN trial. And they included 12,000 patients with gastrointestinal bleeding. They gave a loading dose of 1 gram tranexamic acid plus 3 gram within the next 24 hours or placebo. And the primary outcome in this patient was death due to bleeding within 5 days. So, and these are the results. Death due to bleeding within 5 days was exactly the same in the two groups, 3.8%. There were no difference in this primary endpoint. Also, there was no difference in endpoints at different time states, in different times, 24 hours, 5 days, 28 days, no difference. Rebleeding risk was the same. So, unfortunately, this study did not show any effect on rebleeding and mortality in patients with tranexamic acids in gastrointestinal bleeding. Unfortunately, there was a higher degree of thrombosis, deep vein thrombosis, and pulmonary embolism in the patients that received tranexamic acid. And this study is quite interesting because it's a very large randomized controlled trial, and it's more or less one of the first studies reporting a negative effect of tranexamic acid in a bleeding situation. And not at least a negative effect, but also an increased amount of side effects. And why is this so? Why do we not see a reduced bleeding when tranexamic acid is administered for gastrointestinal bleeding? One explanation could be that onset of GI bleeding is quite difficult to determine. It's not like a bleeding situation in the OR. You know exactly when the bleeding starts. You know also in trauma patient when the bleeding starts, but in gastrointestinal bleeding, it's more difficult to determine exactly when has the bleeding initiated. It could have been going on for hours and even for days before you get to the hospital or before you initiate the treatment. And we know from this randomized trial that more than 50% of the patients, they have bled for more than 3 hours. And further, approximately half of the patients included in the HALT IT trial, they had bleeding due to liver disease. And fourth, and not at least, the dose given in this trial was quite higher than doses given in the trauma and the postpartum trial. So these are possible explanations why we see no clinical effect, but only side effects in this study. Talking about liver insufficiency and the coagulation situation or the status of the patient, we know that the liver produces a lot of the coagulation factors. Not only the procoagulants, coagulation factors, but also the anticoagulants and the coagulants involved in the hypofibrinolysis or the fibrinolysis system are produced in the liver. So they are often in a situation with liver failure, often decreased. Fibrinogen is also produced in the liver, but fibrinogen acts as an acute phase protein. And if the liver is still functioning, but have an in some kind of an impairment, fibrinogen levels are often increased or normal despite liver failure. And as mentioned just before, a lot of the proteins involved in the fibrinolysis are produced in the liver cells, except from tissue plasminogen activator, that's from the endothelium cells. And if you measure fibrinolysis status in liver failure patients, they often experience hypofibrinolysis secondary to bleeding. And surprisingly, despite these situations in which we have a reduced amount of coagulation factors, liver patients, they often experience an increased risk of thromboembolism. This rather large study, they compared a number of patients with cirrhosis with a number of patients without cirrhosis. And as you can see from this table, the risk of venous thromboembolism is approximately double as high as in patients without cirrhosis, despite the fact that patients with cirrhosis, they have a prolonged INR, they have a coagulation factor deficiency, but they have an increased risk of thrombosis. And the explanation for this is that both the pro but also the anticoagulants are reduced in a situation with liver impairment. So despite a reduced production of procoagulants in the liver, there's still a very delicate balance between pro and anticoagulant factors. And patients with liver disease, they have a reduced hemostatic capacity rather than an increased risk of bleeding or thrombosis. And this very delicate balance may explain the observations that when we give tranexamic acids in this situation, this may cause interference with this very delicate balance. So there are a number of tranexamic acid contraindications. First, severe renal failure is a contraindication. If there's a situations with ongoing seizures or a history with seizure, it's not recommended. If the patients have disseminated intravascular coagulation and there's no bleeding, it's not recommended. And if there's an ongoing thromboembolism in the body, for instance, pulmonary embolism, thrombosis in the brain or other serious thromboembolism, it's not recommended. And finally, it's not recommended for bleeding in the urinary tract due to the risk of clot in this area. So to answer this question, is tranexamic acid always good in a bleeding situation? The question is, yes, almost. It reduces the number of bleeding and reduces the number of transfusion requirements quite significantly in a number of different scenarios. Probably prolonged infusion and topical administration is a further benefit. We know quite a lot about the mechanism, although there's still something we do not know. We have to be aware of side effects. We have to be sure when we give it to our patients that they are equal to the study population in these large trials. In trauma, we may in the future tailor our treatment more to give this only to patients with hypofibrinolysis. And then at the moment, based on the HOLDIT trial, as I mentioned, it should not be recommended for gastrointestinal bleeding until further notice. This will be the end of my talk on tranexamic acid, and I hope we can initiate some discussion or question, although we are in this online situation. But thank you very much for listening.